wonderful talk.
Yes. Okay, I will do so. And I will talk about more like the approach I'm doing to modeling, and then I take some examples out, and I will take examples out that somehow are from everyday life most of the time. And what I will emphasize is what we call bottom-down approach, to provoke all these people that talk about bottom-down and top-down and bottom-up, and then they make some funny diagram between data and things going up and down, and you fall. You kind of fall asleep. So bottom-down approach is something where you have a system, you make a model, and then you try to make the model simpler. And you try to make it simpler, and you try to make it simpler. And it's really making it simple. You should make it so simple that you yourself can remember what you did the year after. And that is a tough criterion. So that's what I advocate. So you actually can think about it and use it later. Then of course you're going to miss some part of reality. Hopefully not all of reality, but many details you have to wash out. And I will give you some example from a little bit social inspired examples, and then in the end I will kind of show you that you can go from socially inspired models to actually models of real biological phenomena. So let me show you so the overall theme here, the bottom down, the last part of my circle from before. So you go from the cow to the spherical cow model, and after that you actually hope that you actually learned something about something that was more than just a cow. And my something more than just a cow here is somehow basic features of life, in this case copying and old and new, and try to put this into various models and see where it brings us. Copying old and new, you can see this is a big sister and a small sister, and the little sister is copying the big sister. And that has something to do with also that maybe the big sister has actually something new to teach so the little sister. So there's transformation of new knowledge from somebody to somebody else. That's kind of the game we are going to play. Now, we need some data, we need something to play with, and thanks to my Japanese colleagues, we found a distribution of swear words in Japan, measured by some TV stations. 30 years ago, they went around interviewing people, and then they could see where people used various swear words. And the overall result of this usage of swear words was that they were different in different places. And in particular, there was kind of a tendency, I don't know, is this one even having a pointer? No, that was not right. I better don't. Yes. So there was kind of swear words, and they was distributed somehow from a center, which turned out to be Kyoto, and then you found the same swear word on one side and the other, but then with somehow some intervals of maybe swear words, and then again other swear words, but in concentric rings, which in Japan, which is one-dimensional, seen from physics point of view, means that there's just somebody speaking in some swear words up there, and they're also doing it down there. And then it looks like Kyoto is a center for a generation of swear words. So how do we deal with that? That's a snapshot taken now. They come with additional information that somebody looked in the old annals in Kyoto, and they found out that the swear words you find somewhere up there, you found in Kyoto 600 years ago. So there's a kind of time series, we see just a snapshot of it. So the model for this is fairly straightforward. It is that you make a square lattice on top of a checkerboard lattice on top of Japan. You have a parameter that's a lattice size. That's the only parameter really. And inside this squares, there's people using a given swear words. And the update of it is that people in that lattice point is communicating with people in with the features. What is going to make the features right is that you are not accepting swear words that you have in your previous generation. You are only accepting something new. So if you add that on, that people in this square will only accept a swear word if they haven't heard it before. So that's the other rule you have. You only accept new things, and then you only generate swear words in Kyoto. And then you can generate this pattern nicely, and you can even go in and ask some questions like, how sometimes there's some swear words on one side that's not seen on the other side. That has to do with noise. Noise you control with the size of the lattice, and the size of the lattice should be somehow like 30 kilometer. And then you reproduce basically what you see. And the conclusion is that swear words are kind of stochastically spreading from always accepting the new things, and they spread like one day's walk in one generation. And this new wins over old. New wins over old. That's a fun concept to work somewhat more with. So, of course, we play with that. There's some, of course, corollary. You could, as soon as you have this, you could imagine somehow this could give incoherence over a continent, and meaning that people up there could be angry at the people down there because they actually speak different swear words. So who cares? People can get angry about all kind of stuff. So you can't get an incoherence by this long communication way. So you could imagine a way that you want to minimize this. Modern times you have the TV. In old times you did something else, and the Romans did so. You want to bypass, and the Romans, of course, made a lot of roads so they communicate faster, and then you get more homogeneous distribution of stuff. It's just that it coupled back to how the social system then behaves, how coherent the system is. And that's kind of fun to think about. So in that respect, there's another perspective on new and old. And that is when you look at your behavior with each other, or maybe especially when people start doing becoming serious and becoming old and doing what they call networking, then people are organized in some network and they talk to each other. And you kind of want to model people in some way. What do they actually aim at? And here we are quite positive. We basically say that, first of all, you communicate. People talk to each other. What do they talk about? They talk about each other. That's to 99% of the case, it's roughly what people are doing. They talk about each other. And then in this model here, what they use to, what they get out of this talking with each other is that I get information that you know person B and I know this one, but maybe you get newer rumors, so I get also at that moment that they talk to each other, I also get a picture of who has the newest information. Again, new and old. And that you have new information means that you are a more interesting person. Of course, if you have new information about many people, then you are kind of more interesting, and I will tend to more like to talk to you. And people will somehow do stuff in the social networking games that climb this ladder. And we can put that on computer. And that's what we did. So basically, people communicate over links, and then they build a map of all where other people are, based on new and old. And then afterwards, we allow these people once in a while to climb the social ladder, to build a new link to the friend's friend, in order to get more new information. So you actually don't nearly not put anything into this model. Just this new and old. And orientation and a little bit social climbing. And as a result, you get networks that look like this here. Which means that somebody is in the center and somebody is far away. You get a social hierarchy developing. So there comes another feature into the game at this point. Just from this hunt after new things, you suddenly got positive feedback. That being in the center is nice because you know more about what goes on and people like to link up to you. And then you get even more knowledge about what goes on, and therefore you can create somehow a socially stratified system. Not by money, but by knowledge or information. So it's a very minimal way of thinking about hierarchies, how they would appear in a schoolyard or in some model systems. New and old. And a little bit networking, then you had positive feedback, which also I'll come back to later. It's an important part of life. So we can be somewhat more provocative here about new and old, which we also try. We try to think about ourselves as scientists. And then we somehow, together with Stefan Bornholt, I tried to put Kuhn on computer. Again, a game of new and old. So here we put people not on a network, it's easier to visualize on a square, and people get different ideas. That's all fine. And they try to convince neighbors about their idea. That's the overall opinion formation models. There's a lot of opinion formation models. This little affinity, this model has this additional feature that you get new ideas and you want your idea to win. Now, if you have an idea and you want to publish it, You cannot just publish it. you need to ask some, you need to send it to a referee. So in order that somebody that gets an idea there can convince his neighbor, he first needs to send the paper somewhere random, and this referee will accept it if he had the same idea, else he would reject it. That's an assumption in the model. It might not be entirely true, but it's not entirely wrong. Science is a conservative business. You need to somehow be coherent. So that is a threshold. It's difficult to get your idea percolating if you are just a few people that have it. In addition, we have this thing that if I have an idea and I'm getting convinced about another idea, I got convinced because I got convinced my old idea was not good anymore, so I will not accept to go back to this old idea. That's the second assumption in the model, that I accept new ideas. If I have disregarded, falsified it, or believed that I have been socially convinced, then I will not return to this idea. And that's all. You just put that on that, have these two rules, cooperativity and not going back to old ideas, and you get some kind of lattice which looks like that. And then you let the system evolve, and you see what happened. And you can do that. And this is what happened. You have a kind of, you have the black idea, everybody believes in global warming, something like that, and then other small idea comes up, they cannot really do anything, and then some of the ideas tend to grow a little bit. Suddenly here there's two ideas that grows. They collide with each other and they form some kind of frozen pattern that lasts for some time. And that lasts some time, and then new ideas start coming up, and at some point they sweep and again, and the story repeats. So you get somehow paradigm shift. This cooperativity thing is giving you paradigm shift, that sometimes you get a huge somehow spread of ideas, and then you get somehow a messy period. This is a number. This is the biggest this is the biggest idea in the system. So here it comes up, it explodes, it takes over. This is where high TC suddenly comes in, or something new comes in. Everybody do it, then it fades out as many other ideas come in, and then one of them win, and you repeat it again. And then you can, of course, run this model with different innovation parameters. How creative are people? And the funny thing is that it doesn't really matter how creative people are. The period between transitions is independent of the amount of idea individual people get. The threshold is purely social in this model. It's just tough to get your ideas true. And that hangs on the size of the system, which is kind of funny. And that's it is more difficult to make a paradigm shift in a big system than in a small system. And that speaks to maybe another theme of this conference, interdisciplinarity. We all say interdisciplinarity, but it is tough to penetrate because we as scientists also know that we need to be safe in our own groups. We basically make small communities that makes the chance that the referee knows us and know we're decent is much higher, and then you can be more innovative in small communities. So we know it and we respond to it. I just put the example of some particular barrier of the actual truth. This impressive guy Wegener that proposed the theory in 12, and it took like 60 years for it to be accepted, even if it looked quite reasonably, even at the point he was completely laughed at for a long time. And they just agreed, everybody, that it was ridiculous. There is a barrier for this here, and it's about social consensus. And we should have social consensus in science, but it costs something. And that's kind of fun to think about. So, now I have given you some games. It's social games. It's not somehow strictly science. It's not that easy to quantify the parameters that are in it, but they could inspire us to go a little bit closer on one example of this new and old game. And of course, new and old is maybe most dramatically seen when you get immune to a disease. You get the disease, you get immune to it, and you don't get the disease again. And then you can get another disease. So that is a direct application of spreading epidemics in some way. This here, this model here is kind of like epidemics that are spreading. It's just not epidemics in the sense that a virus that needs to infect you It comes from your neighbor. It doesn't need to check whether somebody far away is also infected. That's not how virus works. It's somehow how the refereeing process works is not how virus works. So you basically take this model and remove the refereeing process. Then you have a virus spreading model. And that you can do, which is giving you, so you can imagine that you have, this is a picture of some kind of spreading process from history. This is spreading of the Black Death in the Middle Ages, and it was really like a spreading process running like a wave across the continent. And the difference here, we are starting to think about here, is that you could have different diseases at the same time. And look at that. And first, we can make some nice art with it, which is this here. So we just initiate diseases, and each ring here is a disease that was initiated at one point. Diseases collide with each other, and they make some nice kind of interference patterns in passing each other. All beautiful art, not particularly right, because there's not that many diseases among us. It's more like a toy. But this is new and old, and something is happening here. So where we have some actual knowledge on new and old and diseases is in influenza. That's something that hits us quite frequently, every year a few times. There is interesting facts about influenza that we could think about. One thing here is that influenza somehow ages. Old influenza strains tend to die out, and new strains are winning. Not only on the level of just immunity, but it's also such that the influenza strain that retains many, influenza is like small particles, and they have different surface features, and influenza strains with surface features has hanged around for a long time, they tend to be weeded out. They get old, and they don't get physically old. The physics is exactly the same. They get old because they are kind of is related to nearby influenza strains that has kind of trained the immune system of all us that it's using as their growth medium. So it generates its aging itself, and we want to be more precise with that. So the data is kind of one of this nice. If you see such a typical chain of this is a branch of influenza, you see that at a given point in time, you have the influenza branching out in many different variants. It's highly overcritical. But only one is winning in the next round. And then only one. In spite of there's hundreds of influenzas actually here, there's only one winning, and that goes on and branches out again. So there's only one winning all at a time. But you are highly overcritical locally. So it looks like, why should only one win? And the reason that one is winning is because the other ones somehow, they kind of weed each other, or they get older. They train the host immune systems. So we should put that in. And that we will do by a model that I still not really have done down to the bottom down level yet, except it's more like I want here to explain new and old in relation to this influenza that spreads over us. This is a picture of influenza, a happy influenza, and it has some surface features. It has a red surface feature and a blue surface feature. In reality, we think there's five different surface features on influenza. That's what literature kind of say. And this influenza can mutate. It doesn't mutate everything at one time. It mutates one of the proteins, that means one of the surface features. And that means that it gets to this state, and then there's a mutant that has this state where the blue one was replaced by a green one. And now that's an influenza that lives in the population. And this one gets a little bit unhappy. You can see when somehow already here you can see there's some disadvantage. This one looked quite a lot like this one, whereas this one has a new feature. It also has something similar to this one, but it has a little bit more new. And that's what makes it somehow has a little bit more to do in the population. And I'll be more precise with this here. So we make a model 5 surface features, different shapes, putting them on the surface of the virus. And then we must be a little bit more realistic with this immune system stuff. There's different levels of your immunity. You can be sick, or just after being sick, you have all these antibodies around that can stop the influenza from coming into you. But after some time, you are kind of don't have the antibodies anymore, but you have the memory. And it takes some time for you to call up the memory and get it working again. And that you put in, of course, and then you put this feature in that that sometimes you mutate. And that means that if you this here mutate in a host, then this host here, if it has a blue memory, well, it cannot deal with it, and this host will be sick, get influenza. And then it will be cured, this host, because you don't die of influenza, but maybe it will be cured by making a red antibody. And that's fine, because then it can stop this one here. So it's in the host, it would be a little bit unhappy in that case. But in addition to stopping this host here, having a red one here, then suddenly there is a host that has a red a defense against the red antibody more than there was before. And there was other hosts that had the red one, so there's somehow generated in the host population some kind of resistance against the old part of the influenza. Put that into the model. So it looks like this here. It's a long and tedious thing, but it's just doing what I'm saying. You can have influenza, or you can be snotty, which is when you have the immune memory against the influenza, then you don't get very sick, but you can actually transmit the disease a little bit. And then you run it, and you get something that looks like this here. So this is a time. This is a fraction of sick people. This is the red snotty people that are dominating. A new yellow influenza comes in. It takes over, and it weeds out the red one, and the red one goes extinct. And the mechanism is, as I told you, that some part of the population are getting immune to the yellow one by getting immune to part of the red one, so the red one is disfavored. And in the competition for host, the red will be selected against, and it disappears. So you get replacement of old with new. I think that's enough. For this here, this is how it looks like on a long time scale. This is your influenza epidemics. The size of the epidemic there, you can read it up there, I don't go into the details down there, but the size of the epidemics here is typically 20%, and that is actually 1 over 5, which is the number of surface features. So it's all fine. Actually, everything here in this model is matching what we could find on facts on influenza. In particular, it fits the fact that if you look at influenzas that mutate, and if they replace a young surface feature with another young one, a new one, it typically doesn't survive so well. If it replaces an old surface feature with a completely new one, it's much larger chance that this influenza is going to be the winner in the next generation. And our model captured that. And then it has a nice little corollary prediction, which we haven't tested. I don't know whether it's right. And that is that you can be quite fatalistic about your next influenza. It is written in your immune system and in the surface features of it. It doesn't matter whether you go close to sick people or not. You will just get the influenza if you don't have the immunity against it. So you can basically just don't care what you do. And that comes and changed from the previous feature of influenza. Because these diseases are all modeled. So the models I'm doing here is close to somehow advanced, susceptible, infection recover model of that category, and they have a famous number that's called the R-naught, and that's how many people you infect. And typically in influenza, to get this 20% infection, as I mentioned here, you talk about an R-naught of 1.3. That's a fairly low number, but now if you're actually only able to reach 20% of the population, then your R-naught is something entirely different. It's more like 3. And that means that you basically are going to get the influenza if you don't have the antibodies against it. So you can take it peacefully and go out with your sick friends, and you will get sick or not sick. It's just written in your, not in your genome, but in your immunome somehow. So that was the overall dynamics here of new and old in this setting. So you had one strain, you mutate, and then you have multiple strains, and then the old one is weeded out, and then you're back to one strain. And so you put in mutations here, and the old strain goes out. That was a message of where new and old are a little bit more concrete than just drawings on the blackboard. So now I will drop the new and old and go to another aspect, this cooperativity that popped up along the way. We used the cooperativity in this Kuhn model, that you need to have refereeing in order to convince your neighbors. And I will use that type of model to discuss gene regulation, classical gene regulation, classical epigenetic phenomena. And this is systems that people are very interested in now. They are associated to all kind of good and bad things. And we work here with a biologist. Genevieve Tone was actually probably the main person in finding this model system in yeast. You see here, this is yeast cell. It is Pompe yeast cell. And you see that one of the genes here, one of the cells is green, or one group of cells, and the other is not green. And this is a particular region she makes a mutant, and this mutant is a stretch on the DNA where she puts in a promoter. It's quite technical, but she puts in something that reports whether this region is open for transcription, is open for activity. And she sees that some of the cells are active and some of the cells are not active. And she also sees that staying in the active state, it can stay there for 2,000 generations of this on this bug. That's a long time. Imagine 2,000 generations for you. You are back before the Neolithic age. Yeast is a little bit more short-lived. But 2,000 generations it can stay there, or 2,000 generations it can stay there, and then it stochastically switched from one to the other, or from the other to the first. And she measured both rates. It's not exactly the same, they're different by a factor of two, but basically 2,000 generations. It's so big that you can build a whole colony of yeast that has one color or have the other color, depending on so you can build a whole society with a given property, because they all will have that property. So, what is a game that's doing this? It's something that happened inside the cell, of course, inside the chromosome, actually. It's happening in a particular stretch of DNA, which is, in this case, 12,000 base pair long, which is like 3 micrometer long. A little thing that's coiled up somewhere in the cell nucleus. And in this sequence, there's just some promoter that has this reporter, and then there's this nucleosomes. And there's no transcription factors in that game. No things that is doing any gene regulation, or they are not producing any gene. There's no feedback from normal transcription factors, just for people that know what that is. The main game has to do with nucleosome playing social games with each other, more or less like we do with our referees. This is the game. The game is, this is, I draw here, is a nucleosome state. So each of the nucleosome in this region, there's 12,000 base pairs. Each nucleosome covers 200 base pairs. There's like 60 nucleosomes, 70 nucleosomes here. And each of these nucleosomes can be in certain states. They can be, in this case, they can be in an A state, they can be in a neutral state, or they can be in an M state. It's methylated, acetylated, and somewhere in the middle. And that's what they can be. And then the funny thing is that they can start convincing each other about whether their state is right or not. So this nucleosome can, for example, convince another nucleosome that you should change from U to M. Like this idea spreading, like a political game. This is a Democrat, this is Republicans. Democrats can convert an undecided to become a Democrat. He cannot not really convert a Republican to anything. But actually, then there's a state over there, a super Democrat that has access to additional funding or something else, and he can actually convince the state over there. So there is some kind of possibility that this side can actually convince this one also. Yes? LSD there. The LSD, this one here is actually, we don't really know whether that is coming from there or not. Whether it is, so this is what I'm here writing what people know about recruitment. The links that come from somewhere to there, that is recruitment process that somebody talks to somebody else. There's also some links in from molecules that just diffuse around in the cytoplasm and do some conversion. And we don't really know always whether this are actually floating around or they are also bound by something else and actually coming from there. But this is so this is this we know. But probably all other things. Yes?
Just that it was interrupted, I just had a quick small question. So you were saying that there's no feedback in this whole system of the nucleus.
Here there's feedback.
Okay.
Here, I definitely didn't say there's no feedback.
Sorry.
That is because this is there is as much feedback as there is in the refereeing process. Obviously, if you have many M states, these M states will be very good in attacking the A states, and they will all slide over, and everybody will become M. And if there's only A states, it's very difficult for them to at all come over there because nobody can attack them. So there's a lot of feedback, a lot of what we call positive feedback, which is really a key in this here. So we have a game with positive feedback, and we have a game with a lot of social quotation communication. This is in another organism. This is the one we use to make the beer we drink in the evening. And they also have similar things, but a little bit different organized. So we make the model, and notice some links I don't know, and some links come from over there. We kind of compress it in this spherical cow way, because it's too complicated to have all these links that are different. So we do this one of these crimes, and that is that we just make these three states, and we make it symmetric. This here, Republicans is converting both of them here, and Democrats can convert both steps here, and there's something in the middle. So that's not exactly, we don't have this links, but it's kind of the idea in the model. And then afterwards we can think about making it either more realistic or simpler. I want to go for simpler. But also sometimes we make it more realistic and then it just gets a very boring talk. So you have these games of nucleosomes on a string, making their social game. And we assume in the first round that this string of DNA is bending around so everybody can touch everybody. There's no real space. And that's a model. It's actually can be written up. This is a full model. And you can put it on a computer. It doesn't fill more than maybe 10 lines on a computer. So you basically, at each step, you have one parameter. So I described it as a zero parameter model, that you always do this step here. That means that you always take one nucleosome. If it is an M, then you take another nucleosome. If that is a U, then you take the U and convert that to an M state. And if the first one was a U, well, then it can do nothing. If the first one is an A, then it's reversed. And of course, if you take an M and already take another M, then nothing happens. And you just repeat that process again and again and again. And that process will just lead to a winner takes all. And we are either going to be completely A or completely M in the end, and the system is dead. And it doesn't fit my data of having a switching rate of 2,000 generations. So I need to do something about it, and to do something about it, I put in one parameter, which is still within the spherical cow approximation. Okay, we kind of rate models according to the number of parameters, and when the number of parameters exceed 3, we say it's failed. One is, zero is of course absolute excellent, then you are really good. And one is good, and two is okay, and three is marginal, and then fail. Just that we want to emphasize it. If parameters is a mess in this game, one parameter is possible to deal with and think about. And this parameter here is a chance that I don't do what I did in the model, that I just do some noise. And the parameter takes into account that when I model biology, I have the thing I believe that's happening, and then I have all the other stuff. And I just want to put a parameter for all the stuff I don't know. And all the stuff I don't know means that I just do something random. And it could happen here because I have a little system inside a big system. And a little system is a big system, and the big system can influence a little system in all kind of possible way. It's dependent on how well Genevieve, when she makes her 12,000 base pairs and surround them with some flanking site, how well are the flanking site isolating the small system from the big system? And that's an issue. So it's a parameter for isolation, for somehow perfectness of the model. And then there's a probability for doing noise, and a probability of doing random things, and a probability for doing what I'm saying. And then you can study the model as a function of that. And then you see, as a function of this parameter, which is basically, this is a ratio between how much I do of the real stuff compared to noise. The bigger this is, the more I'm doing what I say the model is. And what I'm seeing is a time series here. And then up here, I see if my noise is big, then I get garbage out, I get noise. Doesn't work. If the noise is smaller, then I get either I'm in M state or I am in U state, and I get switching back and forth. And if my noise is even smaller, then my switching is just more rare. And that's the property of the model. So it do what it should do. I don't know where my 2,000 generations is here. I don't want to, of course, there's a technical issue here in also having cell divisions. I will jump over that for this talk. So that's a particular additional noise thing that's happening. That at cell division, you have to think, or the cell has to do something. It's kind of added to the noise. So the key idea here is that nucleosome silencing epigenetics is dynamics. It's as dynamics as a social process. It's much more decisive than the American social process. For some reason, many of these democratic processes, they have a way of reaching somewhere in the middle. These systems are engineered to take extreme decisions, which is a good idea because you really, in your cell, you need to be either one thing or another thing and not somewhere in between. And what it comes about is it's dynamic. I mean that it goes on all the time. You don't make memory on the scale of life by just storing it in a crystal. You do it by all the time having opposing forces that do both of them, and then you kind of, when you do perturbations, the perturbing forces can keep you there. But also, if you want to change, you can actually change within a quite short time interval. So you get a lot more power by that way. It's a dynamic process. It's not just a strong binding constant, which is some people somehow, when you look at models of binding, you think maybe sometimes that just strong binding is going to do it. But it's a strong binding kind of sucks, basically. It's either you're never going to get out of the strong binding state, or you have to have so few molecules to get out of it so that it actually would be unstable in other ways. So it's a dynamic process, and it's positive feedback, absolutely feedback. So we'll end up with just trying to make this model simpler. Again, bottom-down approach, not making it more complicated. It's clear that the model is already not really right because it was not really matching, but we're trying to make it simpler and see whether I can make it simpler. And there's various ways I can make it simpler. I could, for example, just make two states, not forgetting the middle state. And I don't want to go through the mathematics here. It's not complicated, but it's just distracting. The main point is that if I just have Democrats and Republicans just across each other and doing this game, then the model doesn't work. It's too soft. You need the middle state to make it work. It's so lucky that we know there's a middle state in the real system, and it actually has a real meaning that you have two steps. And what's happening when you have two steps is that if you have the majority Republicans and a little minority of Democrats and nearly nobody in the middle, if you want to switch and some Republican by accident become moderate, then he needs to again to go against the current a second time to become Democrat. And that means that the likelihood he's going to do it is kind of going it's going down with a power. You have to multiply a small probability with a small probability again, and you get a small probability squared. And that is making a barrier, and that is needed. And that corresponds to a model where I need two Republicans to make a Democrat to convert to a Republican, which is very close to the model I described for the refereeing process. You can convince your neighbor about your paper if a random guy would back it up. So that's and that is a needed part of making decisions in this year. Another needed part, actually I could make it somewhat simpler, but is it really simpler? When I think about the enzyme that should do this here, the mathematics is much simpler. This is a full mathematics of the model. But the enzyme, when you think of the biochemistry, is not that simple. The other feature I could do was to think about space. I was saying that everything could interact with everything. But often in this field, people are talking about spreading of epigenetic marks. And there's a lot of papers about spreading of epigenetic marks. That means that something is spread to the neighbor. And the idea in having spreading is that you don't get whatever is inside a region to go up and modulate the whole chromosome. They just spread locally on the chromosome. So it's kind of tempting to think that everything happened along the chromosome. And we can, of course, make that model. We can say that the Democrat is only allowed to convince a guy that's just neighbor to him. He can only convince an undecided if he's neighbor. He cannot go away and convince somebody that is 1,000 base pairs away. Just put that into the model, and the model failed. It cannot work. So spreading in itself cannot work, which is a nice statement to the field, and I think at least some in the field believed us when we told it. And it's actually trivial from a physicist to say it, because it amounts to something we know from physics, that a one-dimensional system cannot have a phase transition. And if you have local, you basically are one-dimensional. As soon as you do long range, you are kind of... It's not really an equilibrium system, but the argument for why it doesn't happen is equivalent to the argument for a one-dimensional system. It does not have a phase transition. This is really not equilibrium. So we need a non-locality. And then, of course, we have... Now we have all kind of games about we need non-locality, but we also need that things are not jumping all over the chromosome. So that means that we need to make, we are fat challenges here, we need to make the model more complicated. We need to make something local so you cannot really spread all over, and something long range. And then that demands more experiments, and that's somehow where our collaborators are in the moment. So, lessons here was need cooperativity and need long-range interactions in this. And that I learned from doing this bottom-down approach. What was, I put something into the model, I tried to remove the things, and when I cannot remove any more, then I start learning what was the idea in the model. And I kind of need that. Whatever I do with the model, I kind of, not strictly proving it, but within this frame, then I have an idea, what do I really need to make it work? So, overall message, time to summarize. So I started with models of humans, and they are fun. They are slightly difficult to falsify, validate, because it's a mess. And you, of course, when you make bottom-down models, you forget some features of humans. You have to make them somewhat. Here we are just making them as having one state, or just wanting to do one thing. But it can use us. You can use it to as inspiration, because humans are doing so many fun things when they just network, or they decide something is right in spite of any evidence against it. So lots of evidence. They socially, it's like social system of humans are a fun system to look at, because there seems to be so much degeneracy in what they can do, and so much richness. So it can be inspiration. And here we use that as a start for modeling epidemics, and maybe we gain a little bit knowledge about immune systems. If our model is true, we learn a little bit about a way of perturbing immune systems, and of course that's kind of fun. It's a way of measuring some properties of that. It tells about genetic regulation. Here it was about discreteness of life states. Epigenetics is basically about discreteness of life states. And also I think it can be used to go a little bit further and think about biological diversity. In a simple form, if you have cells which can be in different epigenetic states, then you can also make organisms which has different cell types. And there, these mechanisms are useful. So that I will end with that, I think. Yes, thank you.